Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum and salam sejahtera to everyone. First of all, I would like to welcome everyone and thank all of you for allocating your time to come and listen for today's sharing session. And on behalf of the committee, I would also like to thank our speaker today, who is a very prominent person in Malaysia, Datuk Dr. Mohd Daud Bakar, for his willingness to come and share with us his knowledge and insight. As I was informed, this morning he had another two sessions with a scholar from SOAS University. So we know that he's a very busy person and we're very fortunate and lucky to have him today. So for today's session, the sharing and talk would be on being an entrepreneurial mind. So before we begin, let me just share with you a brief overview of how this session will be conducted. First of all, we'll have a sharing session by Dr. Daud himself for 30 to 45 minutes. And after he finishes session, we'll open a Q&A session for about half an hour to everyone to ask questions. So before I hand over, let me just read Datuk Daud background so that we can know him better. Datuk Dr. Mohd Daud Bakar received his PhD from the University of St. Andrews, United Kingdom in 1993. He is the author of Sharia Minds in Islamic Finance, an inside story of a Sharia scholar, which won the Islamic Finance Book of the Year 2016. He is also the author of I Have 25 Hours a Day, The Smart Way to Create More Time. He's also published more than 30 articles in various academic journals and presented more than 150 papers in various conferences, both locally and abroad. In 2016, he also received the Award of Excellence for Outstanding Contribution for Sharia Leadership and Advisory at the London Sukuk Summit Awards and Sharia Advisor Award at the ASSET AAA Islamic Finance Award. Under his leadership, his consultancy services firm Amini Advisors, part of the larger Amini Group, which he founded, also received the Islamic Economic Knowledge Infrastructure Award at the Global Islamic Economy Summit, Dubai, in 2015, and named Best Sharia Advisory Firm 2016 at the Global Islamic Finance Awards 2016. Next, he's also the Chairman of Sharia Advisory Council, Bank Negara Malaysia, and he also serve on Sharia Advisory Council, Security Commission Malaysia, among others. So without any further ado, I'll hand over to this session to our speaker, Datuk Dr. Mohd Daud. Please open.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah, wa bihi tatimu salihat, wa salatu wa salamu ala nabiyil huda wa rahmah. Amma ba'd. Thank you, Brother Shakirin, for reading up my CV and credential. And thank you, the organizers, and particularly the MSB, for allowing me to come for this session. And I have to thank first Ustaz Fitri, Ustaz Ramadan Fitri, in Shawwal as well. It's a joke between me and him for arranging the whole you know, a visit to London and for this kind of talk. I'm very happy that he has been useful to my trip, and we have been working together for the last 10 to 15 years. I would pray for him and for his study all the best, inshallah, because he will be one of the rising stars, inshallah, in the Islamic finance world, because he can combine the traditional knowledge and perhaps the new knowledge that he is learning now in London University. In fact, I was offered to do my LLM in the London at SOAS University. I got the other offer to do it at St. Andrews University back in 1989 or 1990. But coming from Arabic background, not knowing English that well, I decided to go to a very remote university, St. Andrews University, northeast of UK, because I was not prepared to come to London by then. Because you know, you have to put yourself in this position whether you are able to take the challenge or otherwise. But now I'm coming back to London on different capacity. I'm the advisor to a few banks in London. So it doesn't matter where you started your journey. It doesn't matter where you started your journey at the age of 25, 31 years old, 40 years old. Age does not matter that much. Obama retires as a president at the age of 55, where Trump becomes a president at the age of 70. So age does not matter. What is matter whether we are relevant or not in our lifetime. So being relevant is something very close to my heart. I'm talking to the young Malaysian student, perhaps most of you are still young, as I then start Ramadan, or perhaps start Zaini, the rest are still young, but the age, it does not matter at the end of the day. What is more important is the mindset. One of the mindset is your career. You could be dreaming to be someone, which is not wrong. Everyone should have a dream to become someone in the near future, in the short term, long term, medium and long term. But today's discussion will be on a special profession, the profession of the prophet. All the prophets were entrepreneurs. Okay, and this is something which is not being discussed in our community, in the Malay community in particular, because we thought, you know, self-employed profession is the least attractive or least on the list to become someone in our lifetime. I was having the same thinking the moment I'm done with my PhD or back with my first degree. The first thing I was thinking is to send my CV to the public university and to become an employee of the university. And I thought that would be my career until I retire or die, whichever is early. Okay? Sometimes you die before you retire. Sometimes people don't never die. For many years. So after a few retirement, after they retire, they got a contract, they got part-time, whatever. Put aside the joke. Basically, this was my thinking process. Until one day I discovered, I think I can do more. I think I can contribute more to my life, to my family, to my community, if I were to be on my own. And I want to be an entrepreneur. It's up to you, sisters and brothers. If you think you have more ammunition to go further, don't stop at milestone one. You can go to milestone two, milestone three, and whatnot. You cannot do that if you are working under any organization. You have to be your own boss. You have to be yourself. You have to be an entrepreneur yourself. That's why the Prophet, other than the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, toward the end of his life, all of them were entrepreneurs, because they can command their own lifestyle and they can do whatever they wanted to do without any objection. I have prepared a small note for the next 45 minutes for the discussion. Basically, having an entrepreneurial mind is thinking about being self-employed. Self-employed is not, is difficult because you have to pay your own salary. But self-employed is difficult, it's hard because you have to pay your own salary. Which is, what is harder than being self-employed is to employ others to work for you. You have to create job for them. And you have moved away from your own self-employed to becoming a job creator. The profession of job creator is something which is close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because in our life, we need to provide employment to people. Government, normally the modern government, they cannot afford to have 1 million to 2 million. Now they have about 1.5 million under their payroll. Government cannot sustain that big budget anymore. They have to cut the budget. They have to cut the need for the government employees. The same goes to the private sector. They have to look into human resource management, try to bring technology, try to bring the robotic. I'm also in big data analytics. We talk about robo CFO, robo COO, robo CEO, robo designer. In fact, we are talking about robo Sharh advisor already. There's no need to have Sharh advisor to give you advice. We can fall back on the robotic mind of Sharia algorithm. So things has moved a lot. So we cannot be looking at the government, nor at the private sector to provide job. We have to be able to give our own job, and if possible, may Allah give us the ability to create jobs for others. People are looking for job creators, and not many are in the business of job creation. People are looking for job, and not many people are looking for job creation in our society. The other vertical of entrepreneurial mind is to be a risk taker. You have to be a risk taker. If you are not a risk taker, don't talk, you know, about being an entrepreneur. Being an entrepreneur is like being a bird in the early morning, leaving the nest, looking out for something to bring back for the small bird and for the bird itself, relying 100% on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, I was making jokes with my other friend working in the government and private sector. I said, well, I don't think you have tawakal in your lifetime. And they were not happy with my statement. Yes, you may have tawakal, but only 5% tawakal. Because at the end of the month, you will get a salary. But entrepreneurs, we don't know. Even in my case, I'm not so sure whether I can pay my own salary or the salary of my colleagues and employees at Amani Group. So we have to work hard to make sure that I can give them salary for them and for their family. Look simple, we pay, we travel, we do work, but at the back of the mind, we have to be a risk taker. You have to be a bird. You have to put your heart and soul and mind to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So your tawakkal level would be not 100%, 500% or 1,000 kind of time for tawakkal. Be a risk taker. And Allah is great. When you become a risk taker, Allah will look at you more than He look at people who do not have that kind of attitude. The moment you give everything to Him, Allah will look at you. That's why this profession of entrepreneurship is very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the reason I'm going to share with you in a bit. You can add on to that, entrepreneurial mind is normally, all the time, most of the time, a person with an independent mind. He can think for himself. He's not obliged to anyone. He can say, he can take his own decision because he is self-employed and he's not bound by any parameters and limitation. Independent mind. And of course, last but not least, he's a game changer. No one else can be the game changer unless he's independent. A game changer cannot be expected from those who are not independent. You may expect some people to be game changer, but normally game changer coming from people like Bill Gates, people like Steve Jobs, people like Warren Buffett, people like Tan Sri Asia, Tan Sri Tony, and many other people. This is a game changer. Everyone can fly, it's a game changer. Is that right? A new concept. Jack Ma is a game changer. Why Jack Ma Alibaba is so popular? Because he knows people like to be connected. And he put a platform to connect people. And I was made to understand every single day in China, in his Alibaba platform, at least 100 to 200 companies are being registered on his platform. Because they wanted to be connected to sell their product and goods. So this is a game changer. We need game changer in our society. And game changer normally would come from those who are self-employed, job creator, risk taker, independent mind. Only then they are on the right track to become a game changer. Coming back to Islam a bit, I mentioned about the prophets, all of them, except great member of Ustaz Ramadan. I have not seen any one of them were working under anyone except Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, because he was invited, special invitation for him to become the Minister of Finance or Economics or Agriculture, whatever you call it, to manage the budget deficit with regard to the food management back then in Egypt. So the rest of the prophets, they were merchant, they were working on their own, and they were whatever, but they are not, or they were not working under anyone. 9 of the 10 companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam were promised to enter into the paradise direct, fast track, al-mubashiruna bil jannah. And who are these people? 9 out of 10 are the people of business and trade, not even the people of al-fiqh, and not because they are not great, but compared to those who are contributing to the community, these 9 companions were able to contribute more to Islam compared to the other. Sometimes you are good in yourself, and people in our community, somehow I have observed, people thought being good in yourself is good enough. No, it's not good enough. In Islam, you cannot be good for yourself. You have to be good for yourself, for your family, and be contributing to others. You can't contribute unless you have something to give out to the community. And these 9 companions, they were able to do that. And they were able to support the Prophet in the good time and the bad time. Without these 9 companions, the Prophet would have had many bottleneck in his mission of da'wah, mission of jihad, mission of whatever. So those are the companions who were with him financially, supporting him all the way. And 9 out of 10 door of sustenance, pintu rezeki, coming from trading, coming from business. Again, I don't know, coincidence or not, 9 out of 10 for the rezeki, for the sustenance, is said to be coming from business and trading. And normally entrepreneurs are businessmen. And for me, I wanted to add as a one, not in the tradition of the Prophet or the Quran, it's a new power. In our society, we have to identify the source of power. What is the gravity of strength in any society? In the context of Malaysia, we were focusing on perhaps politics, we're focusing on education, we're focusing on da'wah, we're focusing on social engineering of the society. All of them is right to some extent. But we have been ignoring one source of power, which is the economic power of the community. In fact, in the book of da'wah, in the book of politics, in the book of what have you, I've read most of them, not even mentioned about the power of economics. Even Sheikh Al-Qardawi, he has written so many books, but he has not mentioned anything on the power of economics. In the Quran, Allah has mentioned that the power of economy is the foundation of life. Foundation meaning to say, without that foundation, the whole life will collapse. The whole building will collapse. وَلَا تُؤْتُوا السُّفَهَاءَ أَمْوَالَكُمُ الَّتِي جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ قِيَامًا. Do not give the property under your custody to those underqualified, under legal age, whatever, unless they are ready. And this is the wealth that Allah has described, الَّتِي جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ قِيَامًا, that Allah has made this wealth for you as human, قِيَامًا, the foundation of life. Indirect. The Quran, as you know, brothers and sisters, really shared the principle of life direct. You have to extrapolate, you have to deduce and induce from the Quran. So one of the message would be the foundation of life coming from the power of economy. Have you heard about Max Weber? Have you ever read about Max Weber? If you wanted to know about the whole struggle of the world, what is happening around the globe, I would agree to him. He's a Jewish scholar, of course. Max Weber, a German guy. He attributed everything to one thing, wealth. Politics, secondary, everything secondary. What dominates our world is the power of economy. And Max Weber has been right all the time. And I have to say that we have been neglecting the power of independent, power of economy independent, power of wealth, the power of what have you. If you look at our current wealth in Malaysia for the Muslim, it's very, very unfortunate. And the ratio is declining. The KL, the Kuala Lumpur land ownership is being dominated by non-Muslim. And in fact, we are pushed out from KL to areas like Gombak, Bangi, Kajang, and from there we are pushed again to Nilai, and push. Not because we don't want to be in the Kuala Lumpur, but the power of money, we don't have to really have any ownership in that particular area. Why do we need to be an entrepreneur? If you are thinking to be one in the future, I have to be direct, I have to be honest with you. It's good to be direct and honest. From my perspective, entrepreneurship is the only way to create wealth. If you wanted to be rich, you wanted to be multi-millionaire, you wanted to be whatever, you have to be an entrepreneur, not a politician, not an employee. People sometimes they cut the corner and we got a problem in our society. People, they wish to become rich, but they are not entrepreneur. And this is the source of problem. There cannot be any other way other than becoming an entrepreneur in your career and profession. The second point is internalization. Politics have the border. Everything seem to have a border, but not entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship can transcend all the borders of the world. Look at the Steve Jobs and the Jack Ma and what have you. They might not be a good example, but they have shown to us simple idea, simple mind can change the face of the world by having the internalization process. We cannot afford but to be international in our outlook, in our perspective. And the last one, from my perspective, perhaps it's a new rediscovery of ourselves. If we wanted to know about how great Islam is, we have to come back to this area of entrepreneurship. Otherwise, we are not able to rediscover who are we and our good story of Islam. Why we became Muslim? Because our Yemeni brothers and sisters, our godfather, if you like, they came all the way from Yemen to India, from India to Malaysia, because they are traders. Because they were traders, they were international, and they were having the mission to do both, create wealth and also spread Islam in new areas and geography. What is the DNA and the character of an entrepreneur mind? On the top of the list, an entrepreneur mind is someone who is able to see the gaps in the society and to fill the gap. Whatever you can see in the society, if you have the entrepreneur mind, you should be able to identify the gaps and try to create the opportunities out of the gaps in the society. This is how an entrepreneur should do, the DNA. You have to train yourself. You look any value chain in the society, you thought this could be upgraded or upscaled to become a new product, then you are on the right track to become an entrepreneur. But if you see anything in your lifetime, the way they serve the food, the way we manage our mosque, the way we manage our traffic, our waste management, our education, university, the way we put the corridor at the university, the way we look how the nurses and doctors are operating, but we cannot see the gaps, and we are not that ready to become an entrepreneur. An entrepreneur is someone who is able to see any potential opportunities. And business, as you know, in one simple word, is to find the imperfection of the society. Business is about finding imperfection of the society. Not because they are bad, because people need some new services and products for that particular area of imperfection. So this is something you have to train yourself. In my case, whatever I have seen in my travel and career, I'm training myself to see the gaps. I was at the SOAS University this morning. I was passing through the security check and the lift management and the stairs and the waste and the basement. I have so many ideas already of how to make it better if I'm the owner of the university. So this is how you have to train yourself to become an entrepreneur. An entrepreneur is someone who can see the future, of course too far, but at least to see the gaps in any value chain in the society. There are many gaps in our value chain. You look around and you can say, well, it can be better, it can be better. That kind of mentality. a person with this mind is also able to realize the opportunities are abundant and not scarce. Okay? People are complaining. Young people, old people, they were saying life is difficult. Life is this, life is not anymore rosy, life is no longer good for me as a new graduate of the university. And this is not a good character of the entrepreneurial mind. I have a good friend, I think most of you know him, Irfan Khairi, for example. He was a student in UK. At the age of 25 years old, he created the first Malaysian map on Google. And he saw the map, whatever he had designed, and he became a millionaire at the age of 25, 24 years old. So this is finding the gaps in the society and looking at opportunities are abundant, not scarce. The moment we thought the opportunities are very limited, very competitive, we are living in red ocean, they call it, not the blue ocean. Of course, I have another concept. I don't believe in red or blue. I call white ocean, but somehow white ocean has been taken by a Thai scholar, is that right? He created the first phrase of white ocean. White ocean is a win-win case. White ocean is, in Islam, it's about white ocean. We have to sell the product, we can make the people happy, and also we are happy by producing good product to the society. The third character, innovative and curious mind. Curious mind is my focus for today's talk. Everyone must be curious. Okay, whenever you read something, whenever you come across to a statement, whenever you come across to a product, be curious and try to look beyond that. Okay, let's say we take the example of water. Okay, whenever you drink a cup of water, you have to be curious. How did we refine the water? What is the source of water? From the lake, river, from the rain, And how did we refine the water treatment? Are we using the old style of chemical out of raw water coming to the pond? We put some chemical to clean it from virus, bacteria, and smell, and what have you, the color. And as you know, during that process, only 70% can be used as clean water, 30% will go back to the river. Compared to the new technology called membrane technology. Membrane is a like it's a tight tight kind of filtering. The water must go through. According to this technology, about 90% of the raw water can go to your piping and for you to have clean and affordable water at the end of the day. So this is the curious mind. You see the electricity coming to your house. From where the source of this electricity? How much it costs per megawatt and kilowatt? What kind of power plant we are using? The traditional way of coal, or petrol, gas, or solar, or wind, or water? So this is the curious mind. In my area, I can talk more because perhaps you are not aware of that, unless you are doing some research on energy and whatnot. But look into the other small thing in your lifetime. Be a curious mind. A curious mind is very interesting. You become a different character altogether. Don't take and accept everything for granted. Curious mind is someone who's able to at least put some logic behind that, some analytical behind that. If someone were to put a statement to you, be curious and try to, even you are listening to me now, be curious whether whatever I'm saying to you is something very logical, reasonable or not. So be able to challenge at the end of the day. Dr. Daud, I think I don't agree with you on this statement. Then you become a curious mind already. So listen attentively, of course, but also think critically and becoming a curious mind. If you are not curious, you're not going to be a good entrepreneur at the end of the day. And last one, the character, talent development. Talent is to be developed. No one is born to become an entrepreneur overnight. Okay? And many people got to fail before they can be a successful entrepreneur. You heard about Sir Richard Branson. Sir Richard Branson.
Virgin.
We heard about Virgin. But we didn't hear about Virgin Cola. He failed. And Virgin Vodka, two industry, good that he failed on vodka, okay? Vodka is what? Liquor, is that right? Okay, he failed on cola and vodka. But he managed to succeed on airline and music. So he failed. Steve Jobs was a disaster before he managed to produce what I call during my time, Macintosh, Apple Macintosh, and after that he was sacked for whatever reason and he was called back. This is the story of talent development, and you have to develop the talent. I will touch a bit on how can we develop our talent to become an entrepreneur. How do we value our entrepreneurial mind or skill set of this mindset? We have to celebrate both the failure and the success. If you have someone in your family who's trying to open a shop, who's trying to buy equipment at 100 and sell 120, he has put his house on mortgage to get some financing from the bank, and he failed, please celebrate his failure. Celebrate to say, welcome him, give him the support. Even for yourself, you have to celebrate your own failure. Don't take it negatively. The how we value entrepreneurship. If entrepreneurship is easy, everyone would have become an entrepreneur. It's not easy. In my case, brothers and sisters, I set up Amani in 2005. The moment I left the university, on the same month, I set up a new setup. 2 years after that, I wanted to be international, but at the wrong time. I cannot see the future. No one can see the future, of course. I went to Dubai to set up the company in Dubai, and alhamdulillah, the process of incorporation was so quick and smart. Within 5 days, I got the license, not knowing what would happen after that. I got the license today, next week, in August 2008, Lehman Brothers were declared bankrupt in United States of America. That was the blow of my business, not only my business, all everyone's business in the world. So I got to suffer for 2 years in Dubai, paying all the rental, the salaries, my family education, my son, daughters, and my own property, incurring a lot of loss for 2 years. I didn't get any one single dirham. So this is the real case of becoming an entrepreneur. So you have to be ready for that. Sir Richard Branson again has quoted many times. He said, well, the university itself does or do not value the entrepreneurship. We don't have the credit hours for becoming entrepreneurship. And he was saying that in some program of the university, I would agree with him. There's no need to go to the university. If you belong to one of them, let me know later on. Businesses, IT, no need to go to university anymore. Waste of time and waste of money. He said, not me. Okay. So you don't agree with him, blame him. But I support him. Okay. But medical doctor, perhaps legal. Perhaps pharmacy, you have to do some proper education. But with regard to IT, businesses, and finance, there's no need for you to go to university. This is the new way of doing things. If I were to do things differently, I would not encourage any more faculty of business in our public universities. We have to think differently. We have to create a more efficient way of creating entrepreneurs and creating businessmen without going to the university at the end of the day. Last two comments, how to cultivate the entrepreneurial mind. Read a lot of biographies of those who have been successful so far. Don't read the textbook. If you are reading textbook, you may continue, but make sure you read more biographies in your career. You can start from tomorrow, you can start from next week, but please pick up any book on biographies on anyone in this world. Tansi Mustafa Kamal, Tansi Tony, Andendan Krishnan, Tansri Syed Mukhtar in the context of Malaysian. You may read Sir Richard Branson, Warren Buffett, Steve Jobs, and other big names that you are familiar with. It can open your mind and it can show to you how to do things faster, quicker, and smarter if you are thinking to become an entrepreneur in the near future. The second one is to have a strong dream that you are born to become an entrepreneur. Of course, in Islam, you have to put the doa, you have to put the wrapper, the flavor of the dream with doa. Oh Allah, make me a game changer. Oh Allah, make me a game changer. I wanted to be a game changer in the society. And for that, I have to be independent, I have to be strong financially, I have to be able to dictate and not to be dictated by anyone. So this is your dream and your dua. You cannot be a game changer unless you are strong financially. Don't talk about the knowledge. Financially, of course, the knowledge will come at the end of the day. And the fourth, in our context, you have to understand the malaise, the dilemma of our own ummah. Our ummah is suffering from the lack of wealth in our society. We have everything. We have the emotion, we have the knowledge, we have the power, but we are weak financially, and entrepreneurship could be one of the way out. I don't know, but I'm a strong believer in that, because we have tried everything in the last 40 years or 50 years. Even in Islamic countries beyond Malaysia, but we have failed miserably because we have not been focusing on the new mindset to create as many entrepreneurs as possible. unlike the other nation of the world. Though they are minority, they are very strong, they can dictate, they can put the roadmap because they are in control. Last but not least, sisters and brothers, to conclude, I'm a dreamer. I'm not the only one, of course. All the successful person, their job is to have a good dream every day. You have to have your own dream almost every day. If you cannot dream, you cannot be an entrepreneur. In fact, you cannot be anyone in this world. Being able to dream is the starting point. What would you be in the future is something that you have to be doing that every single day, and inshallah, Allah will open the opportunities and in order to make your dream full of motivation and inspiration, read the biographies, talk to people, learn from those who are successful, and open up your mindset that this is a new way for me. Of course, I'm going to have my degree, I'm qualified intellectually, but I have to be able to do more than working as a employee and supporting the organization. Perhaps after some time of working with others, the time would come for you to be on your own and to be able to contribute more and more to the society. I think with that, I wanted to stop my presentation and open up the floor for any question, easy and difficult one. Okay, thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you to Datuk Dr. Mohd Daud for his interesting sharing. Next, I'll open for Q&A session. So, anyone wants to volunteer first to ask questions?
Assalamualaikum and hi everyone. My name is Amin Awi. I'm a first year student at City University, studying accounting and finance. So I have a question for Datuk. My question is, how did you manage to introduce Islamic finance concept in terms of international financial institution, especially here in UK? Mm-hmm. And what are their feedbacks about the Islamic finance, which prohibits the interest-based transactions?
Okay.
So that's all.
I think I don't do much because I'm not a shareholder. I'm just a Shara advisor. That's why compare my position to the shareholders, they are much better. They have the upper hand. That's why we have to understand Shara advisor, we don't do much. We just see the product, we just endorse the product. Of course, people look at me as great, and I'm not great compared to the shareholder. Those who have the money to invest. And who are these shareholders? They're not from here. They're from Gulf, from GCC. How many banks here? Four or five banks here in UK. None of them is being supported by the British. I mean, in terms of shareholder. I think we have one from the Bobian Group in Kuwait, and then from the Qatar, and two from Qatar, and one from Abu Dhabi and whatnot. So, in the final analysis, the shareholders are the one who call the shop, not the share advisors, not Ustaz Ramadan, not Dr. Dawood. That's why we feel ashamed because we cannot contribute, because it's about the power of money. We thank them because they wanted to help the Muslim community to have the access to Islamic finance over here. Even our own Muslim community over here, they are very wealthy, but they don't believe in Islamic finance. Not even one local Muslim is a shareholder of Islamic bank here in the UK. Again, curious mind. For me, I was reading through the report. Who are the shareholders? I thought we have many Pakistani, friend, Indian Muslim who are good, multi-millionaire, and they should be the potential shareholders, but they are not. They are neither a shareholder, and sometimes they don't even go to Islamic banking and finance. They are very much flexible with conventional, though they go to the mosque, they have value chain or supply of goods and services, but they are not. Again, I put my curious mind, who are the shareholders and who are the customers to Islamic Bank? They are not. The one who come to many Islamic Bank here in UK are the normal guy, the SME, doing the laundry, frozen food, technology, construction, and they are not even Muslim. They are a normal businessman on the street. They wanted to have financing. For them, Islam has no religion. They go and they take the best offer. But coming back to our own concept, Muslim in United Kingdom are not part of the system, which is a failure. I can say that because I have the data to support my statement. Again, having the encouragement. So if you are an entrepreneur, can we set up another bank where the shareholders are 100% supported by the local British Muslim, for example? This is a good idea. But the problem, they're not coming forward, or coming, they're not forthcoming. There should be some reason. Why are the Muslim, the British Muslims not coming forward? Lack of knowledge, lack of whatever. And it's very, very unfortunate story. I think you wanted to say that I'm the one who influenced. No, I didn't. Shara advisor cannot influence. I wish I can influence. If I have the money, I can influence. That's why we need to be financially strong. We can put our own bank, the way we do things differently. But shareholders, they are the one who call the shot, and they are taking the risk. We have to thank them, or the four or five big family and organization in Gulf, in GCC, coming to UK to put their money, taking all the risk, because under the Central Bank of England, the framework is not that ready. The framework is not ready, and we have seen many problems in terms of asset liability, risk management. In term, nowadays they are introducing many new regulation to make asset banking finance in a very difficult situation. But put that aside, it's not your job, but you have to see the contribution of the stakeholders. I'm one of the stakeholders, but we are Shanghai or below. So I have to be honest with you. I can speak of myself, but there's no point of speaking of yourself, seeing the value of your contribution is nothing compared to the shareholders' contribution to the whole system.
Assalamualaikum, my name is Hanan. It's an international relations from LSE. I have two questions. My first question would be, last year I had the chance to intern with an Islamic finance bank, and I had
in Malaysia.
And had a lot of interactions with, for example, Daud Bakar from
India. Yeah.
So what I realized is Islamic finance products are relatively more expensive, and it hampers people from participating in.
Are you sure?
This is the question. This is the direction of the question. One, is the statement correct? Because I work in a rent to own product. So it was
in Malaysia.
In Malaysia, okay. Yeah, with Maybank. So and throughout studying and analysis of different products produced by banks in Malaysia, I realized that Islamic finance products are more expensive. That's one thing. Do you agree? And if you can counter-argue that.
Which product are you talking? Mortgage or trade finance?
The product I was working with was mortgage.
Mortgage.
But, yeah.
Okay.
Secondly, do you see, I'm not sure if you're familiar with Rushdie Siddiqui.
Yes, yeah, very so, familiar. Old friend.
Okay.
Same-ish.
He produced a lot of articles about how we need to capitalize on Muslim markets.
Yeah, he wanted to be like Jack Ma.
The Jack Ma of the Muslim world.
Call it Alibaba.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, Rushdie Siddiqui, apart from our conversation, he mentioned that UK has a lot of potential, but it's not utilized. So, you as an entrepreneur, what are your ideas upon such opportunity?
Okay. Femi?
Yeah.
Okay. I think in the case of Rushdie Siddiqui projects to make Islamic Alibaba, after all, he left the company already after 2 years. In fact, I was telling him it's quite difficult for you to become an Islamic Alibaba. If Jack Ma were to know about your project, he can simply convert his platform to become Islamic platform, and everyone will die. very risky kind of idea. That's why entrepreneurship, you have to be smarter, you have to be great in your strategic thinking. I told him, don't take the risk, because platform is platform, has no religion. You can change, you wanted to buy Islamic product, this is Islamic platform. We screen out or we carve out product which are not compliant, or the entertainment, pornography and weaponry and tobacco related alcohol, then you can kill off his project. I have seen his research, he and many other good friend of mine, he tried to come back. We call it incubator system. We have to incubate the young entrepreneurs in UK, in Bangladesh. They need the incubators in Sri Lanka, in Malaysia. In Malaysia, we do have incubators somehow, which is quite strange. We talk about entrepreneurship, but we don't have any incubators. I think the idea of incubators, at least by Rushdie and his colleague, to set up like we have in San Francisco, California, and perhaps Singapore, they have many incubators. Singapore is one of the best incubators in the world. They are small, they are dynamic, but they have so many IT, pharmacy, doctor, engineer, property guy, they have the incubators. Perhaps in the case of Malaysia, if you have some money, I can collect your money, 10,000-ish, perhaps, jokingly, okay, to set up the incubators. Incubators is something that we need to do in the near future, to help people like you to be trained and to know whether you are having DNA or otherwise. Sometimes you are not born to be entrepreneur, so be it. Be someone else. It's not, I'm not saying entrepreneurs are much better than the employee. I'm saying from my first statement, if you know you can do better, do better. Take more risk. This is my statement. I'm not saying here that entrepreneur is the best person on this planet. No. I'm saying if you can be an entrepreneur, you can have more influence. If you can be. But if you cannot be, so be it. You can be any other. You can be Musa Ash'ari, you can be Abu Hurairah, you cannot be Abdul Rahman bin Auf. So be it. It doesn't matter. Because each of the company have their own value in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I forgot the first question already.
The pricing.
Okay, there was a good joke about a couple, old couple, at the age of 90 years old. So he tend to call his wife darling all the time. Darling, darling, give me water, give me this, give me that. And one day people attracted, intrigued by his attitude. And they ask him, uncle or grandpa or whatever it is, where did you tend to call your wife darling all the time? To be honest, I forgot her name. Okay, so I forgot your first question already. Age factor. What was the question?
Expensive. Yeah.
Have you seen the data? To be honest, they say. Okay, you have seen the data. Let's say Ustaz Ramadan is here. Let's say a property in Bandar Seri Damansara, link unit, same cost price, let's say 600,000, financing for 30 years, Islamic and conventional. And Islamic happened to be a bit different, a bit higher, sorry. Are you sure about that?
What we did last year. So that's why I need to clarify, like, what is your opinion
of it? Okay, for me, if that is true, correct me wrong, you have the expert working inside the bank. I'm not the working inside the bank, I'm the Sharia advisor. Normally, the way we calculate the profit, we tend to put the median. Let's say the floor is 4%, the projected BFR. BFR stands for
Base
finance rate for Islamic,
BLR
for conventionally. So let's say BLR is at 5%. We put our own median, the average one, let's say 6%. So 6 and 4, of course, every month the installment will be higher, because 600 is different from 4 multiplied 600 per year for 30 years. But we have the ceiling as well. Conventionally, during the period of 30 years, the BLI will move as we are move as well. That's why the installment will be reconciled at the end of the day. That particular poor customer conventionally has to top up if the BLR has gone up throughout the period. The same goes to Islamic. But in our case, we fix the price all the way. They say you pay 1,000 a month, I have to pay 1,200 a month. Still expensive, is that right? More expensive. But at the end of the day, in the market to decide. For the poor, for you, after 30 years, when you're about to retire and take the money to enjoy your life, you were to be told, sir, you have to pay more under conventional system. This is people, I mean, this is something that people are not aware of. Having said that, I don't think there's an arbitrage anymore in the Malaysian market. If Maybank were to do that, I have to to check further whether that's true or not. The cost of fund, Islamic and conventional, has been removed entirely. When did you do the internship? 10 years ago?
No, last year.
No, I don't know.
I'm not trying to speak up to my point. I was just want to ask your opinion about for example, it's not true, right? What about the perception that Islamic finance
yes.
are still more expensive?
Perception, everywhere I go on this topic, people tend to add the same wording that you have used just now. Exactly word by word, same thing everywhere in the world. I don't know what's happening to this world, yeah. So, Ustaz, wanted to comment? Not to defend Maybank.
Yeah. I just need to remind myself not to overshadow Dr. Daud on mine. But I think maybe some of my broad answer, I may need to sit down with you to understand when you do comparison, whether this is apple to apple comparison. Because there are a few things that we need to take into consideration. First, if you compare conventional banking, it always between creditor and borrower. So the relationship is very clear. So actually the risk is all transferred to the customer. The bank has no obligation over the property. But if you compare to some of Islamic products, for example, and if you take that as example, rent to own just now, the title ownership belongs to the bank. So bank bear the risk attached to the property. So the risk profile is not the same. So it's always a maxim, a well-accepted maxim that no risk, no return, higher risk, higher return. So because of that, the risk profile of the product is not at par. So because of that, it's very important for us to make sure that our comparison is apple to apple and we not compare apple with other fruits.
Sure.
Yeah, and that is one thing. And second thing, let's say this is not based on rent to own or musharaka mutanakisa. This is based on debt-based products. I just want to re-emphasize what has been mentioned by Dr. Daud just now, that again, we cannot compare between a fluctuated loan with a fixed rate loan. Because for fixed rate loan, for example, no matter how volatile the interest rate movement, the financing rate between the customer and Islamic banks remain at that fixed rate, unlike conventional loans. So again, the comparison between Islamic product and conventional product must be, at least we need to find some balanced parameter to do comparison. So again, doctor, this is a very broad answer. I may need to sit down with that sister just to ensure that we have a very clear comparison. Wallahu a'lam.
I take a few financing instruments for my property, particular property. I'm a very good in terms of calculation as well. As a way, I will not take Islamic. But I have not seen any arbitrage in the market.
Yeah.
I have not seen. It used to be the story about 10, 20 years ago, because we don't have money market
yeah.
product. We have to borrow more expensive from the third party source of funding. But now we have interbank money market. If I need 100 million for 1 week, one day I can go to the other bank and borrow at a cheaper price. It was true during Bank Islam and Mu'amalah time, but nowadays I suspect the data was not presented properly. I mean, this is my thinking. Otherwise, we are not happy with our state banking in Malaysia. more expensive, more inhuman, if you like, and not giving the proper alternative to the swim and the swim.
Assalamualaikum, my name is Zainuddin. Studying chemical engineering in UCL. Going back to the topic, I have a question on one of the statements. You're saying that the only way to create wealth is through entrepreneurship. But I have a few friends who are actually making money, a lot of money, through investing in the stock market. And that's my first question, like, what's your comment on that?
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, I have a few friends who are investing in a Bitcoin. So just to make sure, is it Islamic? If it's not, would it, is there any chance that it would be Islamic in the future?
Okay. I think investment is part of entrepreneurship because you are the king in your decision. You have 100 million, you have 10 million, you have 1,000. You decide yourself where to invest. And you do work with others. You are the one who make your own decision in terms of portfolio, asset allocation and whatnot. So you are, by any standard, an entrepreneur. Okay?
But how are you a change maker if you are an investor?
Sorry?
How are you a change maker?
Because when you're an investor, Warren Buffett is an investor. He's also an entrepreneur. He started his career as the newspaper boy. Goldman Sachs started as clerk in the bank. But he knows how to do the investment banking trick by leveraging and whatnot. He became an entrepreneur. Goldman is an entrepreneur bank. Goldman is based on partnership. Each and every senior post in the bank, they have some share in the bank. This is entrepreneurship. Our bank are not entrepreneurship. It's owned by shareholders. They're concerned about the bank, but they're not entrepreneurs by nature, unlike some of Western Bank, Mercury and whatnot. So this is the new way of doing banking now, is entrepreneurs driven. Investor is also an entrepreneur because he does not work for others. He works for himself. This is an entrepreneur. And he can create a lot of money. Warren Buffett, he does not create his own business. He invests his money and his investment in other companies. Did he have factory? He didn't have any. Unlike Bill Gates, he owned his software, or property software. But Warren Buffett, the second richest man in the world, he didn't own any, he didn't have his own business. He didn't have his own property business. But he invested in other company. He knows where to invest and how much to invest and where to exit. So this is he's good at. He was quoted to be saying, "I sing the song that I know." But I thought he was true to his statement. But during the dot com he didn't touch. But during the financial crisis, he was involved in the financial derivative to some extent. I think so, if I'm not mistaken. He was also implicated by not investing in something that he's not aware of. The second issue on the Bitcoin. If you have a company doing Bitcoin, let me know. I wanted to invest. Meaning to say, if any share are combined. Okay? It's good to invest now because now it's still cheap to invest. But you have to take the risk of the government risk. Government might come one day and ban the transaction through Bitcoin. You can go to the supermarket, you cannot buy and sell anymore because government has stopped the payment system through Bitcoin. But from Sharon's perspective, we have done the research and we have endorsed one client in Saudi Arabia. They wanted to invest few hundred million, not to buy the Bitcoin, to invest as a shareholder in the company producing the coding of the Bitcoin. So a very good investment if you can take the risk. But for me, you are still young, don't take that risk. Too risky. It's too risky kind of investment. But if you have some extra money, you wanted to buy one Bitcoin, nowadays about 3,000 in Indonesia. Used to be 200, now 3,000, can be 10,000 in the future. So buy one or two for fun's sake. Buy just for the sake of fun, to learn how the Bitcoin can resolve. if it is haram in the future, just throw it away.
Yeah. I mean, check it out.
So it's Sharia compliance. Because
from
our friends,
from my perspective, yes.
Because there's a website I found that they give a link on fatwa in Malaysia saying that it's haram. It's not yet Sharia compliance for now.
I think the problem of our scholars, some of the scholars, when they do not know things, they tend to give haram. 85% of haram fatwa coming from this ignorance. Not because the haram in real fact. It's good to be cautious. Cautious mind is not good. Courage mind is good. Cautious is not Islam. Cautious, wara, taqwa in your ibadah to Allah. But when it comes to giving the fatwa for the community, you either know it or you do know it. You cannot give the fatwa based on ignorance. You have to do research. I do know the fatwa, but give me some time to research and come back to you. But don't simply say it's haram because it's too tricky, too uncertain, not obvious. And most of the fatwa are coming from that door, which is very, very wrong. Okay. Yes.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I'm Fauzi, the Cambridge University.
Dr. Fauzi.
Dr.
Fauzi. Ramadan, my close friend.
I'm also close friend to him.
Right, Datuk. Thank you very much for your sharing knowledge and wise words from you. Anyway, I have a few questions, but before that, I just want to share with you. Few years ago, I was interviewed by Harish Bibang, and I want to say sorry, actually. I use your name because the interviewer asked me if something happened related, I mean, issues related to Sharia, who I will consult. I mentioned your name, and probably because of you are the prominent figure at that time, and luckily I was offered the job, probably because of your name. Alright? I didn't take that job. I didn't take that position. And now I'm being academic. Anyway, my question is about your topic today about entrepreneurship. You mentioned about wealth, wealth creation, and so on. But there's notion that wealth, the more wealthier persons, the more greedier they are. So it's proven when. In 2008, financial crisis, people blames greedy people in Wall Street.
Mm-hmm.
So, how do you see this, and how do we overcome?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I think Muslim entrepreneurship should have this kind of, to overcome this problem. But probably you can share with us. Another thing is about dealing with Arab. We heard that. Hanky-panky, people of Arab, but you managed to overcome the problem with Arab people. How did you manage doing business in Dubai, especially? And another question is about Islamic banking. Although I was part of it because I studied Sharia. People argue that, probably a different question with the sisters, that Islamic banking or the banking system itself promotes credits,
consumerism,
consumerism and so on. And also, Islamic banking promotes money creations, which is the basic foundation of conventional banking.
Yeah.
What's in it? Thank you. That's all my question. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Now question becoming harder and harder. I think greed and becoming greedy is part of our DNA. Okay. Even the first criminal case on the planet between the two sons of Adam is part of that nature.
Okay.
We cannot stop greedy. You cannot stop people becoming greedy. And you cannot use the greedy attitude as the excuse not to be richer and richer. We have to fight the greedy. we cannot use the argument to say if you do that, you get to be much more greedy, and for that, you cannot be a richer guy in this world, which is wrong concept. In fact, that is true. In Islam, the higher you are, the more you are being put under imtihan, under ibtila. Even the Prophet was saying, liyabluwakum, in the Quran, and the Hadith was saying that those who are subjected to tribulation more and more will be the Prophet themselves, because they have that position, they are the messenger, they have the flagship of Islam, they got to be subjected to many tribulation more than the other people. That's why it should materially correct, because if greedy is not good, it's a simple thing. Sorry, if the wealth is not good, there's no tribulation, that is not good about to become wealthy and to become richer. But the fact that to become wealthy is always subjected to a greedy kind of attitude, that shows that this is a perfect theory. A perfect theory that for you to go up, you have to take all the tribulation. You have two options. Either you be richer and wealthier and pass the greedy test, or you do not do anything, which is the option for Muslim. Either you take all the challenges and the tests, or you don't do anything, become a very poor country, poor people, begging from the people. Even we cannot save all Muslim in Rohingya and Myanmar, because we don't have the money to help them. We cannot save our refugees in Syria, because we don't have the money to help them. This is coming back. Nowadays, they are suffering in Jordan, in Istanbul, or Turkey, because the financial. We don't have the program for social finance. And even our big brothers, Arab countries, are not supporting them. They have the money for whatever reason. So we need the money. We need to become wealthier to really help the community moving forward. Of course, we have to pass all the tests. Even the poor people, they fail the test as well. Many poor people are arrogant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, the Prophet said, they are closer to kufr when they become poor. When they have nothing to eat, they tend to reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, life is not perfect. Our life is not perfect. But we have to be the most perfect according to our capabilities. But of course, we have to remind our Muslim entrepreneurs, when you become richer, don't change your lifestyle. You have to be modest, you have to be human, you have to be thankful to Allah, and you have to give more back to the society. But you have to expect some casualties. You have to expect some casualties. Some of them, when they become richer and wealthier, they tend to forget not only themselves, the family, but also the God, the Creator himself. Arab. I don't think there's difference between Arab and non-Arab. People are people at the end of the day. So they have good people, good Arab, and also the other type of nation. Even in Malaysia, even in Indonesia, in China, I travel a lot into Indonesia, I travel to Philippines recently, I travel to China, I travel to Middle East, travel to Europe. They are the same. The DNA of human is the same. But you got to be smarter when you deal with them. Make sure you follow the laws, due diligence, risk management, background checkup, AMLA. You have to do all the research, the credit story of the client. If someone wanted to bring you the project, make sure you have the original title of the projects. It's not a broker. You have to do the research. Even in Malaysia, we have been approved by so many people. Upon checking, 2 days only a check, they are not real. So it happens everywhere in the world. So don't be biased against anyone in this world. Okay. Third one, consumerism. Consumerism is part of our modern lifestyle. People like to be seen as having good lifestyle, even though they have to borrow. So this is a phenomenon, nothing to do with halal and haram in our society. In fact, the central bank has already cautioned our Malaysian banks, don't over-finance the consumer sector. We have to stop now, because our household debt compared to our GDP is one of the highest in the world. We need to say the bank like giving the loan for credit card, car financing, personal loan, mortgages and whatnot. These assets are not productive. I was in Muscat last 2 weeks and Central Bank of Oman has given a new guideline, which is good. You have to give the financing 55% to the corporate sector and 45% for the consumer sector, which is a good policy to balance. But I was saying to them, the central banker, you should have done this 10 years ago, not during the crisis. Because the time is not right for you to give, because the bank got to survive. Nowadays, to find a good corporate is not easy anymore. In fact, it's good to focus on the corporate, on the consumer side, because corporate is having a problem of doing business. So very risky to the bank to give the financing to the corporate in the case of a slowdown of the world economy at the moment. So in Malaysia, I cannot say it is halal or haram, but it's up to the policy to reduce the consumerism. I have some data to show that many of our Malay government officers, they borrow more when they're about to retire. That's why when they retire, the debt on their balance sheet that they have to serve will take them another 20 years. And they don't have the income anymore. And this is happening in Malaysia, because there are many ways for them to start to continue borrowing. I hope the Malaysian government and the credit bureau of the country can put a very stringent procedures not to allow any more borrowing when they are at the age of 55 years old. Because that will kill off their EPF. When they got EPF, within 1 week, the money... And this is the problem of our society. What is the solution? Financial literacy. We are very poor in two things. In knowing the financial planning and also in embracing the entrepreneurship. So, yes.
We'll give a chance to...
Because you mentioned about financial literacy, right? Because I guess we are all students and we have a small amount of cash that we have with ourselves. So how do we, as youth, carefully plan or take care of our money?
It's extra money or within your day-to-day expenses?
Extra money.
Extra money. How much? £100 a month? Average.
Maybe.
I think you have to invest that money. You have to invest that money. If I were you, I'd buy gold. But not physical gold. Gold account. Gold account. No need for you to have physical gold because the gold is going up. Nowadays, it's a trajectory, an easy investment. No risk. Whatever happened to this world, gold will be gold. Is that right? So this is something that you can do that. Or perhaps, if you can be a member of cooperative society in Malaysia, put your money over there, because it is good, 7 to 8%, plus tabung haji, plus PMB. It's a safe investment. No need to have someone like Ustaz Ramadan myself to advise you. We advise you, you charge your fee as well, then you're gone already. So, gold, tabung haji and the PMB and also the cooperative, kooperasi muslimin, whatever, there are many cooperatives in Malaysia. Choose a good one, I think they are able to give you 7 to 8%. Here in UK, I'm not so sure. Perhaps there's some is an investment account, I'm not so sure, but do some research.
We'll be accepting one more questions. Okay, maybe two more. Right. How many questions do you have?
About three or two.
I'm okay. I can be here until 9 o'clock.
Okay. We'll proceed with two, three more questions and
maybe two questions.
Two.
Two
plus two.
Like one each.
Mm. One each? Because there's one person on the last question.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Maybe after you can meet.
Okay.
because I got questions from a friend who is watching online. So okay. I think it's better to ask the questions.
Okay. Good excuse.
Okay. Yeah, assalamualaikum, Datuk. My name is Farhan. Yeah. I'm a student here. So a friend of mine who is watching via FB Live asked me to convey these two questions to you. So the first question is, okay, I'm reading out. We know that Malaysia by law is not yet prepared to have a single financial system for Islamic finance. What do you think the future Islamic finance system in Malaysia? Should we have a single financial system which is Islamic finance, just like some Middle East countries? Or should we maintain the current double system which are conventional and Islamic? So that's the first question. And the second question is, what do you think about jihad business that has been done by Tan Sri Muhammad Ali Hashim? Is it practical? Should we take his idea totally? Is there any improvement that can be done? So that are the two questions. Thank you.
How about your question, yourself?
I don't have any questions.
Okay. Let me start off with the jihad business authored by Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Ali Hashim. I think his idea is great, is good, but it's not good enough. Because in order to create wakaf, you have to create wealth first. Many people are talking about wakaf and zakat, which come at the end of the journey. I personally don't subscribe to the idea of talking about wakaf all the time, because wakaf is about using your current wealth into a new platform, but not creating the new wealth in the society. We have to talk more of wealth creation. If we don't have wealth, don't talk about wakaf anymore. If we don't talk about zakat, because if we have the GDP for Malaysian as a whole, GDP, you know, the income, they call it household income for Malaysian, again our GDP, Malaysian household income last year based on World Bank is about $10,756 per household, which is around what, 40,000 or let's say 50,000 for the whole Malaysian. But I have the feeling if you carve out our Chinese colleagues and friends and citizens of Malaysia, our household income for Malay and Muslim will drop from 10,000 to $1,000. So how are we going to talk about wakaf if our household income is only $1,000 to $2,000 a year? That's why I was telling Tan Sri in many platforms and many other seminars, perhaps we should stop talking about wakaf now. We should be talking about how to create new wealth in the society. Because wakaf come at the end of the journey. It's easy to do wakaf, but it's hard and difficult to create more wealth in the society, to increase our income every month, every year, in our young generation and you know, the existing Malay and Muslim community. So this is something that I have to put on the right perspective. It's good to have wakaf, it's good to have zakat, but if our baseline, no baseline, is not good, then your wakaf cannot grow. Wakaf, we need Abdul Rahman bin Auf, we need Osman bin Affan. If you have Osman and Abdul Rahman bin Auf, wakaf cannot be ruled out. That's why this is something I'm bringing to the society. In many platforms, myself and Tansri, we were having discussion. Of course, he wanted to promote wakaf creation. I wanted to promote wealth creation first. Two different school of thought. If we have the wealth, wakaf creation will be the easiest thing to do. But now, we don't have the wealth. So this is the problem I wanted to be speaking to all of you and also the viewers in the FB Live. Focus more on wealth creation and focus more on high income, disposable income, if you like. Not only high income, but also this disposable income, which is the most important thing. We earn 10,000 a month, family-wide, but we pay the loan, we pay this and that education. Some of the children are studying in London. Every month is asking some money. and disposable income is only 1,000 a month. 1,000 a month is not the right income you're talking about. The second question, single and dual financial system. I don't think we have any country in some world having one financial system, not even one. I think your colleague was saying about some in the Islamic country, Middle East, none. And I would say it's good to have dual financial system, at least we put in our law. In other part of the world, we are the only country in the world stating clearly we have dual financial system in the law. At least people cannot challenge it anymore. In other part of the world, they are silent. They have a banking, they have also the conversion banking finance, but they have not put in the law. In our case, we have the FSA and IFSA, Islamic Financial System. So we have two current stream of the financial system. I think let the community go through the whole journey. Islam is not about compulsion. Let the society in Malaysia see the beauty of its financial system. If you ask me to impose one financial system at the current time, I don't agree to that because we have so many shortcomings in our system. We are still learning and we are still trying to fill the gap. So it's good in the long run, let the Malaysian community, Muslim, non-Muslim, see the beauty of the Islamic financial system. And in fact, the danger of having one financial system, we tend to take it for granted. There's no competition, there's no quality control, there's no upscaling of the product, services, the efficiency, the IT, and the presentation of our financial system. So let the two systems run concurrently. And Allah will decide at the end of the day what would happen to the financial system for the Malaysian in the future.
Can we go to the gentleman first? Assalamu alaikum. My name is Mohd Daud Bakar from Datuk Malaysia Hall London. And I have this one question. We know that Muslims are encouraged to give sadaqah. So depending on our income, probably we allocate 100 or 200 ringgit to give sadaqah, but the problem is which one to give. So we also have one platform.
You mean the beneficiaries?
The beneficiaries, yes.
You're not so sure about that?
Okay,
you're
not so sure about that. Okay. So we want it to be grow from our sadaqah, is it? To grow in beneficial
way. Yeah.
Not grow to syndicate or things.
Yeah.
So we have this kind of platform, which is a crowdsourcing platform,
yeah,
in which it is a website that we can scroll and see with what business models, startups, mm-hmm, or probably difficulties people have, and we give something to them in terms of sadaqah or probably buy equity.
Yeah.
So what do you think about this platform in improving, mm-hmm, the entrepreneurship among the ummah? So yeah, it complements,
okay,
the pledges and also the givers. Investors.
Okay. Great. Crowdfunding is a good idea. It started in 19th century of AD. I think the first project was the Liberty Statue in USA. It was funded by crowdfunding. And most of the time, crowdfunding was not meant for commercial return. It was meant to help one another in the old time. I wanted to publish a book. I wanted to build a house for the community. I wanted to buy a car for the society. I just put my intention. I'm the manager of the project. Put your money and I'm going to do it for you. But somehow it evolved to become equity crowdfunding and also debt crowdfunding to offer my investment portfolio to everyone coming to you without going to the bank, without going to the financial or to the fund which are regulated by the central banker. So it's a new way of doing investment, direct investment, without going through the system in the country. There's a good and bad of doing that. So we have to put some regulation as well to make sure that the money, particularly the raw money, the unclean money, does not come to the system, because it can be used by some people to simply put the corruption money money coming from illegal acquisition. Because in the banking system, we have to ask, who are you? If you bring the money to the bank, 100,000 and above, you have to answer so many questions. But crowdfunding, no one is there to ask you. So we have to put a certain regulation as well to protect the purity of the source of money and the AMLA, Money Laundering Act. Okay? So let the regulator solve that problem. For me and you, it's a good platform. We can encourage. But I'm not happy with the system at the moment. I have been advocating that we have to put the GPS system so that we can trace the donor or the contributor and where does the money go to. So it can give more confidence to everyone, regulator, the recipient, donor, and also the community at large. And $1 coming to this particular project will be the value that $1 has impacted on the project. We can give more school to the poor student, we can buy new clothes to him. So the GPS would be something that we can put in. And GPS is not rocket science. GPS is not rocket science anymore. So if we can couple the crowdfunding with the impact measurement and the GPS system built in, I think you can create a new revolution after the French Revolution.
So except entrepreneurship?
Yes. Even entrepreneurship, let's say you are from Imperial College, you did engineering, for example, you wanted to go back and to have a new bottling technology. I need 100,000. You declare to the whole world, I need 100,000 to do everything. This is not environment, I wanted to do it environment. Water without bottle. Idea, eh? Water without bottle. Yes. So it's a good thing. I encourage you to think about crowdfunding, but crowdfunding has some problem as well. It's not perfect either. I think
one more.
Last question.
Salam.
Ada apa pun from USA. Yeah. My undergrad was in USA. I attended Dr. Muhammad Hussam.
Yes. Lecture.
Workshop. Yeah. Islamic economics. Mm-hmm. And his basic definition of riba is just if you have capital, and then that gives if you pay it longer, it becomes more, every month. And also if you have a different amount of capital, same period, you have to pay more, and then also reward.
Different capital?
Yeah, I mean different size. That is the basic definition that always been troubling me until now. Yeah. So that means that basic definition, especially in borrowing. So how do you overcome it? And they talk about the Islamic economy and so on. And to me, of course, this is prescribed by God, by Allah. We have to have 100% trust in it. And I believe because our ibadah is, we have salat and zakah.
Yeah.
It's just like two wings. We have to have two wings to fly. And on the part of salah, under the God, basic ibadah, we are very good, I think.
Mm.
We can know every detail in everything. But in respect to the other wing, on zakah or mu'amalah, probably we are lacking very little understanding as a whole. And this is what keep us not flying very high.
Yeah.
And because different understanding maybe, so to me, if we really have a 100% Islamic system, financial and also economic system, to me, even the non-Muslim want to become Muslim because of this limitation of true Islamic economic system.
Yeah.
So how this this is my question.
Okay. It's a very tough question, to be honest. You have touched on a very important subject matter, which is far more far-reaching compared to our discussion today, entrepreneurship and financial system. It's about the whole economic system, demand and supply, wealth creation, wealth distribution, and also the development of technology to replace or to replenish the resources which are going down. The land for plantation has dropped. Most of the land in the world, in China in particular, were affected by the overdose of the chemical fertilizer and insect, call it insect. So most of the and people population has grown up from 6 billion to 9.5 in the 2050, and when it comes to the end product of the plantation, the cereal or the fruit and the corn and soybean, we have to compete with animal nowadays. In fact, in our data, only 10% of the consumer of food item or human, the 90% goes to the cattle sector because they need to eat nowadays, and we need their protein. Without animal, there's no protein in this world. So this is the ecosystem how Islam has put it and how Al-An'am has been narrated. And only today I come to realize how important Surah Al-An'am is. I've been reading Al-Quran over and over and over, and last few days I discovered, I have put in my Tazkirah Jumu'ah, in my FB Live, FB whatever, every week, I was commenting on the importance of land, water and plantation. And this is the very fundamental for our survival. We can live without technology, we can live without electricity, but we cannot live without food and security. الَّذِي أَطْعَمَهُمْ مِنْ جُوعٍ وَآمَنَهُمْ مِنْ خَوْفٍ. Two vertical, food security and real security. So this is the challenge we are talking about. And Islam come not for the riba sake, for the gambling sake, profit, avoid this, avoid that, punish this, punish that. Islam is not about that. If that is the case, Islam will be very easy to be implemented. Islam is about civilization, how you deal with land, with the water supply, how you capture, how you put in the proper reservoir, and how you distribute, and how you manage the environment. In our atmosphere, which is 700 kilometer thick, but going to be reduced due to the emission of carbon dioxide. So this is the new thing, and that's why I'm not saying that our discussion is not important, but as we discuss and we put in the financial, the economic, the life, we have to be, if you like, we have to take cognizance. We are a living organism, and Sharia is living organism. The Quran is living organism. Everything is living organism. In fact, in the last few weeks, I put another proposition. We cannot be talking about fiqh Islamic law in five categories: ibadat, munakahat, and muamalat. These are the old classical definition which are outdated anymore. Already, sorry. We cannot rely on that definition anymore. We talk about waste management, water treatment, the governance, the disclosure, the related party transaction, which is the source of corruption in our modern time. So we have to rewrite not only the Western theory, but also our own theory. We have to rewrite again most of the Islamic fake discussion. We are talking about Islam for the real life. That's why when you mentioned about the economy, I was intrigued that we have to see how Islam comes to put all the sector. The Quran mentioned about cattle, Quran mentioned about rain 100 times. There must be a reason for that. Water supply, water treatment, and so on and so forth. So this is something we have to go back and read our own Quran and to understand in new perspective. And I don't want to comment on your official riba, very philosophical, but toward the end of the session, I wanted to impress on you that Islam and Sharia is a living organism. Quran is very living and dynamic, but the problem, we have failed to make it dynamic and living in our society. So every single thing in the Quran is important. I have discovered, I have been a scholar for the last about 40 years. I have been reading Surah Al-Asri, I don't know how many times, in UAE, our university, after limiting Al-Asri, after limiting, without understanding the meaning of Al-Asri. Why it's important to talk about Al-Asri? Because one of the fundamental Al-Asri, it's not about time though, what I also will have, check and balance. Check and balance is very powerful, fundamental in Islam. Al-Haq is not about me and Ustaz Ramadan. Al-Haq is about society, it's about the component of the life. We have, in our translation, we call it Pesan, Memesan, Perkara yang Benar, has no value, has no meaning. But we put check and balance, we know Islam is about checking the proper distribution of power, to check and to provide the balance that someone is not going to misuse the power and so on and so forth. So, to conclude our discussion, and I give you some time to comment on the presentation later on, respect to the moderator, I would like to say that we have to see the Sharia from a new perspective. Sharia has been neglected by the Muslims themselves. The way we interpret, the way we want to enforce Sharia, according to our own eyes, and not to the wisdom and the knowledge of Allah. Islam is not naive. The way we interpret Islam is very naive, very simple-minded interpretation. Islam is beyond that. Islam is about building civilization, not only for Muslims, for non-Muslim environment, ecosystem, and whatnot. And this is my new way of doing things. I wanted to bring Islam in a very lively and dynamic and human. In my own words, kita kena memanusiakan syariah dan mensyariahkan manusia. And with that, I would like to thank you for your time. Some of you have come all over from Manchester and what have you. Thank you for your support, and I wish you all the best in your study, in your sabbatical leave as well. Some of you enjoy your study time, read through all the books and biography, don't forget. And read a lot of biography books. Inshallah, you can come and see me one day. Dr. Daud, your advice has been working well on me. Inshallah. Thank you very much. I hand over the microphone to our moderator. Thank you very much.
Thank you to Datuk for his very interesting sharing session. So that marks the end of our session for today. So before we dismiss, I would like to invite Ustaz Putri to give a token of appreciation to Datuk.
Thank you so much on behalf of Education Malaysia.
Education Malaysia, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Okay. Thank you for everyone.
Okay.
Ni dah pressure time ke keluar?
Okay.
Thanks.
With that, wabillahi taufiq wa hidayah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi
wabarakatuh. Assalamualaikum. I'm here for the next 15-20 minutes for you wanted to interact with the couple that I'm here.
Yeah.
Then have another interview with one student actually. So I'm here for the next 15-20 minutes. Thank you, brother.
When you say Yes, please. 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 Yes, please.